الحمد لله
سبحان
الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين ما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا صدق الله العظيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى سيدنا مولانا محمد وبارك وسلم Respected Sufi Ikram, Awliya Ikram, Ulama Ikram, brothers, Assalamu Alaikum Warahmatullahi Wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, it's great to see such a mahfil of those who are sat here in the remembrance of Allah and His Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I was blessed to be in the company of the great late Sheikh Sufi Aslam Sahib Rahmatullah Alayh. He blessed me with his du'as a couple of times, and I am sure that his spiritual presence is here with us today. And just by seeing such a gathering of devotees tells me how true of a straight path the Shaykh was on. We gather here today on the Mawlid in the remembrance of Rasul Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and for us every second of our day is the remembrance of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I remember one of the sayings of one of the shuyukh who said, Shaykh Hasan Sadli Rahmatullah Alayhi, Shaykh used to say that if the presence of the Prophet was not in front of me even for a second, I would feel that I have come out of Islam.
Allah.
So these were awliya kiram who used to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam everywhere they looked.
Allah.
And why not? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily he did a favor upon us. A favor. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a life. He has given us wealth. He has given us health. He has given us family. He has given us friends. He has made us the ashraful makhlukat, the best of creations. Out of all the creations He's made. But not at one time did He say, I have done a favor upon you. But when He sent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, He said, verily I have done a favor upon you by sending the best of all mankind from amongst you.
Subhanallah.
So you can understand that this favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done cannot be even regarded in equal to our life. It is above that.
Allah.
Because if our life was a favor, He would have told us so. So dear brothers of Islam, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to this world, he changed people's lives in the positive and the most positive way that no one in the history of the creation of the earth has ever done.
Subhanallah.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared mankind to be ready for that day and be ready for that era when the best of mankind will come. And hence the previous prophets came and they give da'wah ila Allah, towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they always gave the tidings that the last of all messengers, the best of all mankind will come. Now alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed us that we are amongst the ummah of Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the biggest sacrifice given were those who were around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the time. What made people who used to bury their daughters alive, what made those people who you did injustice to their women, to their children, to their neighbors, to their orphans, suddenly change that direction? A way of life that they had been living for years, for generations. It was known that if there was a child who had no protection, then people used to take that child's goods. People used to leave that child completely unsupported. But when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him to also experience orphanage by sending him as an orphan as well. So that Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could tell the people from personal experience. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when a person looks towards an orphan and he puts his hand on the head of an orphan, in shafqat, in the rahmah, in mercy, then that person and I will be like this in paradise together. That one statement changed the attitude of all the generation towards orphans. In the same way, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us about the women folk. Now, when we look at the West today, there's a lot of arguments about Islam and its treatment of women. Sadly, Muslims may treat their women badly, but Islam has given a prestige status to women. And what I mean by that is that those who follow the deen of Allah and His Rasul are not always an example to follow. The examples to follow are the awliya-i kiram and best of all the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because when you can look at that example, you'll be able to understand that what status the Muslims have given. For example, if you look at the status today, you will see that women are allowed to do business, women are allowed to inherit money, women are allowed to work for a living. But if you then reverse time back to 1400 years ago, you will never find a single example of one woman in the Western culture who was allowed to run her own business and also allowed to inherit from her inheritors. But you will find that example in the vicinity of Makkatul Mukarramah and Madinatul Munawwara when Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave that status to women. Wow. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Hazrat Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha and allowed her to continue running her business like normal. That was never heard of in any culture. And that's when the Prophet ﷺ showed us how much of a status a woman has. And that's why in different examples he has given the status of a mother. The deen of Allah and His Rasul ﷺ tells us how to live our life and how to be with our parents. And the Prophet ﷺ, even when a person came to become a believer, the Prophet ﷺ always warned them that they must be good to their parents. Even if their parents were not believers, even if their parents were people who hated Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hazrat Sa'da radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that my mother said to me that I will go on a hunger strike if you do, unless you turn your back on Islam. She said to him, I will go on a hunger strike unless you turn your back on Islam. And Hazrat Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to his mother that, dear mother, if I have to not give one, but 100 lives of yours for the sake of Islam, I will not turn my back on the deen. Now, alhamdulillah, what a statement by a sahabi. But think of this, that when the Prophet came to know about it, he admonished Hazrat Sa'ad radiallahu ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, wa bil walidayni ihsana, to tell the sahaba that even though your parents may tell you to do something which would hurt you, you will never raise your voice against your parents. You will never raise your voice. And this is the deen of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if you look at, mashallah, there's plenty of young brothers here today. And it is a great sign when I see young brothers in the mahfil, because that is the spirit. That's the spirituality towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I firmly believe it's the spirituality of the shaykh that is bringing you towards Allah. Because there's many people out there, and we see our youngsters today, and when it comes to the mahfils, we'll see the older generation, because they're thinking, well, I've got not long to go. So, you know, what time have I got left? I'll spend in the Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when you see youngsters doing that, that really gives us an example of how the heart has been purified through spirituality. And Hazrat Thalaba bin Abdul Rahman radiallahu ta'ala was a sahabi who was 16 years old. And his job was to run errands for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How lucky was he that he used to do errands for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he one day was running an errand for the Prophet, and in them days the houses had parda over them, they didn't have solid doors. And hence the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always gave the hikmah that whenever you go past someone's house, it is haram for you to peek inside someone's property. And this young man was only 16 years old, and as he was going past the house, one of the curtains blew through the slight wind, and his eyesight went towards a woman who was having a bath. Immediately, he looked down, but that picture was in his mind. And he thought to himself that I have become a munafiq. I have become a hypocrite. I have done something which Allah and His Rasul has forewarned us of. So he then runs towards the mountains. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inquires for a few days, where is Talaba? Where is Talaba to the Sahaba? And no one knew. So the Sahaba, the Prophet instructed the Sahaba to go and look for him. This young man was in the mountains, used to come down just once to have a little bit of food and water, and he used to go back in the mountain and he used to cry in repentance for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every day he was crying and crying in the repentance, and ultimately the Sahaba were told that there is a young man that comes down from the mountain, he may be the person you are looking for. So the Sahaba went up there and they saw this young Sahabi who was in such grief for that one incident which occurred, which in genuineness, it occurred through mistake. However, his guilt was such that he believed that Allah would reveal a verse to the Prophet about his hypocrisy. So he said to the Sahaba, I cannot face the Prophet. When the Prophet the Sahaba went to him, he said, I cannot face the Prophet because how am I going to face him? Surely there's been verses revealed against me. The Sahaba satisfied him and consoled him, telling him that nothing as such has happened. You should come with us. So this young man then followed the Sahaba to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he came to the Prophet, Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his blessed hand on the head of Hazrat Talaba, and he put his head on the lap of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, have I been cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no such thing has happened. And at that point, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could see the angels coming down to take his soul away. So the angels came and this particular sahabi passed in the lap of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But when the time for janazah came and Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam bathed and he was shrouded, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking with his janazah and he was tiptoeing. And the sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, how come you are tiptoeing? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, because I'm finding it difficult to move because of the angels that I can see in front of me. And this is the example of when a person is truly devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that individual was such committed to Allah, his repentance was so true to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is what happened to him, and this is his akhirah. So dear brothers of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one nazar of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam changes a person's life forever. And his life, the people, the Hazrat Musab ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, think about, and the examples I've given is for children, if you look at older men, but if you look at rich people today. But this Hazrat Musab radiallahu ta'ala an was one of the richest of Makkah al-Mukarramah. In fact, it is said that the shoes that he used to wear were equivalent to 4 months' salary. So if in these days, I know there's lots of expensive designer wear out there, but Hazrat Musab ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was one of those who used to wear the latest designer wear clothing, if you could use that as an example. And when he used to walk the street, the street used to smell of the scent of the expensive perfume that Hazrat Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala used to wear. And for hours later, you would know that Mus'ab has walked through the street. Because that's how well looked after he was. However, when he saw that there were a few people gathering in Arqam's house, his curiosity led him towards there. And what did he see? He sees the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whom everybody was talking about, because it was the newly advent of the proclamation of the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and people were talking. So his curiosity led him there, and he sees that there's a few people, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is bending in such a way, he's prostrating in such a way that his heart got attached to it. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw, he smiled at him, and Hazrat Musab's heart started to pound. And Hazrat the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his blessed hand on the heart of Hazrat Musab radiallahu ta'ala and it calmed him down. And he says that it is as if Allah had opened my heart and a light had entered into it, and he became a believer. But as soon as he became a believer, that is when his difficulty stopped. Because the money and the wealth that he was he was using was his mother's money. It was his mother's wealth. And when the word got about that Mus'ab has become a believer, his mother disowned him. He went to Africa, Abyssinia, and emigrated. And when the news got out that people in Makkah were okay to follow their deen of Allah and his Rasul, and that was the false news, he came back. And when he came back, he got captured again, and his mother would capture him, and she would leave him in a corner without food and water. She was staunchly against the deen of Allah and his Rasul. Hazrat Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala saw an opportunity to escape, and he did. And then one day, and then she said to him that, "I will disown you if you," and he said, "I am not in need of your goods." Now, the same person who used to walk the streets, that they used to send, and the clothing, now one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sat with the Sahaba, and they see this young man coming. The Sahaba looked at him, and tears started to roll from their eyes. His clothing was ripped. He only had one piece of clothing to wear. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "See that person? This is what you call the true commitment to Allah and his Rasul. And he has given up every luxury, and Allah has accepted it." And then Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala was given the act, the challenge of going to Madinatul Munawwara as a da'i ilallah, as to give the da'wah to the people of Medina before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emigrated. Hazrat Mus'ab was overwhelmed because Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar, the great close companions were there, but the Prophet chose him. But Hazrat Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala give da'wah to Madinatul Munawwara, and he then took place in the Battle of Uhud. And the important part is this, that when the word got out, that the false word that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been martyred, some of the Sahaba turned their back and started to run away. Hazrat Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala ran towards the enemy and said that the deen of Allah is true, and the deen of Allah and his messenger still lives, even if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has passed away. And he was martyred. He went into the battlefield, and if those people have been to Uhud, you will see the first three graves. And one of the graves of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and this other grave of this particular Sahabi, Hazrat Mus'ab radiallahu ta'ala, and Abdullah ibn Jash, the three Sahaba. And the point is this, that when the Sahaba were collecting the bodies, they called the Prophet, said, "Ya Rasulullah, we are burying the bodies of the Sahaba, but we've got a bit of a situation." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and he said that this is Mus'ab ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala an. "However, we have only enough cloth to cover him, that if we cover his face, his feet are left uncovered. And if we cover his feet, his face is left uncovered." The tears of the Prophet rolled from his eyes so that the area around him was moistened with his blessing tears. Because he remembered the very Mus'ab who used to walk the streets in beautiful clothing. And now today in his burial, he hasn't enough cloth to cover his body. So they covered his head and they covered his feet with grass. And he was buried. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "There are people true to their word, and Mus'ab, you are one of the truest of those people." So what I'm trying to say is that when it came to material wealth, when it came to, and what made these people change? It was the coming of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was the milad of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that made these people change. Abu Dharr Ghafari radiallahu ta'ala was from the Ghifar tribe. The Ghifar tribe were known among Makkah and all of Hijaz as the highwaymen, the bandits of the highwaymen. They used to rob people. And one day Abu Dharr Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala came to Makkatul Mukarramah, and he got in touch with Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala. Although Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala hadn't openly accepted Islam, he told him about the deen of Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Abu Dharr Ghifari was one of those who would never remain quiet. So he went into the middle of Makkah and started to shout on top of his voice that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And the people pounced on him and they beat him up till he was unconscious. And then he got consciousness again after a little while, and he said the same thing again. "I don't care about my life, but I would need to tell you what the truth is." And the people attacked him again until Hazrat Abbas said to the people, "He's a man from the Ghifar tribe. Let me tell you, if you kill him, then your merchandise and your businesses that are leaving Makkah and coming back to Madinatul Munawwara, you will find that those businesses will be attacked by these tribes." So they left him alone. But however, let me tell you one thing. Hazrat Abu Dharr Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala an was so loyal to the Prophet that in the battle, or when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went in his last battle, he was left behind. And the Sahaba carried on walking, and Hazrat Abu Dharr Ghifari was, you know, he'd been left behind, but you could see the historians explain it as that he was like a dot walking in the sand. And the Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw from a distance, and that he said, that's Abu Dharr Ghifari. He lives alone, he walks alone, and he will die alone. And now let me tell you that after Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world in front of our eyes, it was the time of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And one day Hazrat Ali was walking and in the desert, and he was called, a couple of people said to him, a person has passed away. And there was a person living in a tent on his own. When Hazrat Ali went there, it was no other than Hazrat Abu Dharr Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala an. As the Prophet had said, he will die alone. And this is the Sahaba, they didn't care what their destiny held for them, because they knew that their akhirah was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So dear brothers of Islam, through the spirituality of the Shaykh, you must maintain your commitment to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You must maintain your loyalty, just as the Sahaba did when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was chaos when he passed away, but the loyalty remained up to the extent the Sahaba went far and wide to spread the word of Allah and His Rasul. You must ensure that the dhikr of Allah and His Rasul and the way that this silsila continues that dhikr is spread across the globe, inshallah. And I have absolutely no doubt, through the spirituality you have in front of you, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep having the spirit of the Shaykh amongst us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.